Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats.
You know, you never expect it to be such a lovely place. And if you're within the sound of my voice, that must mean you are in the seats with once more. I'm getting a little punchy, but that's okay. As always, my name is Dave Voigt, and I'm the host of this podcast, where we sit down with a wide-ranging variety of industry professionals and pick their brain about current projects, state of the industry, how they got started, and so very much more in a light and conversational fashion, because that's just how we do things around here. And if you like how we do things around here, I'm assuming you do, you're listening to us right now, you can subscribe to the podcast. We would love it if you did that. You can find us over on Apple, Spotify, Amazon, Google, basically wherever you get your podcasts. And plus, we archive every single one of our episodes over at our In the Seats YouTube channel, so if you can give us a like and subscribe there as well, we'd really appreciate it. Also, we're on the social media. We're on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at either at In the Seats or at It's Podcast One for all sorts of updates. But plus, we're also on the TikTok for just a little bit of fun at In the Seats as well, so please join us there too. However, finally, and this is the moment where I get a little somber and get a little serious, please visit us over at In the Seats, intheseats.ca, for all the latest and greatest from the world of film, television, video on demand, film festivals, reviews, news, interviews, basically anything we can think of, because our team loves writing about it and talking about it, and we love it when you come read about it. So please do us the kindness and stop on by. On this episode, we're going to have a little bit of fun, because, we're going to go to that lovely place. It's a joke that, I only find funny, but the season 2 of Hotel Paranormal is kicking off this coming Friday on the T&E Network, so please check with your local providers for anyone up here in Canada. It airs at 9 p.m., we had the distinct pleasure of sitting down talking with producer Sarah Zammitt about the upcoming new season and just sort of the process therein and how they put episodes together, how they do the research to sort of find these stories and really make it sort of a fun ride as we see. It's not a question of, them trying to sell us or making us believe. It's they're really sharing stories of experiences that happen to people, and they're doing it in a real entertaining and fun way. And we had a great talk with Sarah about just sort of the structure of the show and the structure of the series and how they've managed to do everything together, especially during COVID, which I can imagine added that many more complications to it all. But If you're looking for anything a little bit spooky and you have the T&E channel, please go check out Hotel Paranormal Season 2, which starts this coming Friday at 9 p.m. But first, enjoy our talk with Sarah, because it's a good one. Now, I mean, I guess just to kick it off, I mean, I watched the first episode. Obviously, I got a kick out of it. I enjoyed the first season as well, but there's something I'm always curious about with a show like this. Mm-hmm. How do you go about sort of the research process and just sort of finding the right story to pair with the right theme? Because you can't obviously put stuff up randomly. You have to have themes and you have to have sort of ideas that go across the whole episode.
Yeah, I mean, it goes from research into pre-production into production, and even in post, I'm making those decisions. But, first and foremost, I guess we're looking for, stories that, and particularly in this season, like stories that we haven't heard before, like events, paranormal encounters that are a little bit different, people who are really interested in telling their stories. Often people in this season in particular were telling them for the first time, which was interesting. We were looking for stories where people, more than one person sort of could speak to the encounter. So there's a number of factors that go into, selecting the stories, first of all. And then, there's pairing the episode by episode sort of happens over the course of the series, and putting them into themes. Some are apparent right away, and then others we shape as we get into post-production.
No, I mean, I've got to imagine, especially sort of in the pre-production stages, you've got a lot of different ideas on the go, especially when you're just sort of learning about different stories, but also vetting them as well. I can, like, how many do you have on the go, especially sort of in the early days of planning a season, when you eventually start to whittle them down?
Oh, gosh. I mean, it's different. I mean, season one, there, you know, you could, I think we went through, gosh, if memory serves me right, 60 to 80 stories, maybe even more. You know, and the researchers, you know, and associate producers are amazing. You know, they really reach out to a lot of people they follow. They look online and reach out to experts. And you know, there's a huge network that they sort of tap into. And so, you know, we're constantly going through stories. So, yeah, there can be, you know, 80, 90 stories easily that we're dealing with initially, and then you're starting to pare them down, you know, based on, you know, sometimes, you know, in the second season, it was based on travel more than anything else, because when you're making a show in a pandemic, it was really about how can we get the largest number of people to, you know, in a safe environment to be able to conduct the interviews. So that dictated some in this season, actually, some of the story choices, even though I was, you know, really, really, really thrilled with the quality of stories and you know, season one, but season two as well. So I don't feel like we compromised, but certainly that was a factor in decision-making this year.
When you've got something like this and you're putting it together, I'm always fascinated just in terms of not just vetting the stories and sort of determining that it's right. Because, I mean, I can imagine you sort of have a checklist of multiple factors to determine, like, okay, this seems like a legitimate story. But also when it comes down to staging sort of recreations and that kind of thing as well, like, can you walk me through a little bit of particularly the recreation process? Just because I'm always kind of fascinated in that, because it's one of those things that it adds an extra layer of production on your end that a lot of people don't necessarily take into consideration.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, it really, for me, the recreation layer starts in the interviews. I mean, you know, I feel like we have, you know, had very, very strong interviewees. So it's interesting when I'm listening to the interviews, I can already picture, you know, what, how to bring that story to life. Like, some, you know, the stories are very rich, the interviewees provide a lot of texture and information and emotion about, you know, the you know, what happened before the event, leading up to the event, during the event, right after the event, and then, you know, sort of how those experiences change them. So, you know, so that's always a really, I mean, I love that part of the process of really getting, you know, interested and engaged and immersed in the storytelling, you know, so there's that part of it. But then, yes, you know, there's script writing, there's, you know, making sure that we are staying true to the storytelling, and then, you know, casting, obviously, and trying to get people that look similar. And, you know, in some cases, we can, you know, we can sort of accurately, you know, recreate the environment. And then in other cases, we're of the hotels. And then in other cases, we're not naming the hotels. So we're, you know, we're creating a different environment. So that can change, you know, the flavor of the story a little bit, but we stay, you know, true to the central facts of the experiences that the people have. So I love the process from that moment in a dark studio to, you know, to being on set and then in the edit and seeing it all come together based on that first kind of glimpse into someone's experience. I love it.
Now, is that the hallmark for you for a good story? Because, I mean, I can imagine that some of the interviewees you would talk to, like, they would be very willing and they'd have a lot of details to sort of tell your story. But I can imagine there might be people who you'd have to maybe pull more information out of during the interview process.
I guess so. I mean, you know, I find it, you know, again, it's as individual as each interviewee. But, you know, I'm not the kind of producer that, you know, I'm only interested in what people are willing to share. So,
right. Okay.
So, you know, I don't try and put words into people. Like, I'm truly interested in what the story was. And I'm like, tell me what happened and why. And I'm really interested in digging into, well, what do you think happened? Why did that happen? Where did it happen? How, you know, so less about, can, you know, it's never, you know, can you say, it's more like, let's dig in. So tell me more. And sometimes, you know, people haven't been asked, you know, and I always, that's part of the discovery in the interview process. Once you're in, you know, when someone's sitting down and willing to tell the story to you, you know, we really mine them. And that's where, you know, that's where all of the kind of really special moments of the show happen for me, is when, you know, someone sits for a minute and goes, oh God, yeah, okay, this is what happened, you know, and, you know, it's no more complicated than this, or I hadn't thought of it this way, and this is exactly, you know, what I felt, or I have talked about this, and you know, I'm going to share this with you, and I'm just a curious person, so, you know, I'm just like, take me on the ride. I want to know what happened, and I want the viewers to go along on that ride. And, you know, I think the challenge sometimes is that if, you know, people get blasé, I think that's more the challenge, you know, that, oh, well, I saw this, you know, this thing came out of a wall. Well, that's not ordinary, you know, that's not an ordinary event. So let's dig into that. I think that's more my style.
Now, I'm curious, like, coming into something like this, like, do you have to be a believer, or is it better if you come at it from maybe the skeptic point of view when you're producing stuff like this? I'm always kind of curious to see if, like, sort of, if you believed going in, would that sort of taint your view going forward on how you produce the show, or if it's better to sort of be a skeptic and let somebody prove it, kind of thing.
Yeah, I mean, I honestly don't think too much. Like, I'm mostly interested in what people believe they experienced. So, you know, my starting point is, you had this experience, I believe. Okay. So, you know, tell me about it. I'm not like this show and this process, you know, we're not there to discredit. We're not there to question. We're not there to say, you know, does, you know, and there are occasions where, I've definitely, our team, you know, we definitely ask questions of, you know, you could see how someone wouldn't believe this, or you could see how that's contradictory, or you could see, like, I like to, you know, to push and to dig in. But I'm not there to say whether this happened or didn't happen. I'm there to say, tell me, you know, I'm here to listen. Tell me your story. Tell me what happened. And we are going to bring this to the world. And I think that's, you know, as viewers, it's for skeptics and believers alike. And, you know, it's truly, you know, the world of the paranormal, I find, and what I find compelling about it is the curiosity that people have, and the openness that people have to things that can't be explained, and things that can't be seen, or things that are unknown. And, you know, it really gets to the core of the issue of, you know, what happens to us when we die? Where do we go? You know, can we connect with loved ones? Can we, you know, how do I deal with my own mortality? Like, there's some really, really profound questions that get grappled with in the paranormal. And I know that's something that can interest everyone.
No, and I think that's what I like about this show, because it very much presents it as an emotional document, really, to sort of really make us understand what these people experienced. And I'm kind of curious, from your perspective, what got you into this business about sort of telling stories and getting to know about other people? Because really, this is such a personal show, and these people are telling such personal stories in really many ways that it's really fascinating to watch.
Oh, great. Yeah, that's what I... Sorry, you cut out there a little bit. I'm sorry, I couldn't hear some of that. I do feel like that it is personal storytelling, and you know, I'm very grateful to the contributors. And, you know, that's what's important to me, is to kind of honor what they experienced and what they went through, and the words that they want to use to share and their storytelling with us.
No, and you know what? It comes across honest and truthful, and it's an entertaining show as well, and it's kicking off again this Friday on the TNE network, if I pronounce that correctly. This Friday at 9 o'clock, I believe.
That's right.
And I hope everyone gets a chance to check it out. And thank you again for the time, Sarah. This was a lot of fun.
Oh, really great chatting with you. Thanks so much, David.
And don't forget to visit our friends over at Bay Street Video for all your DVD, Blu-ray rental or purchasing needs this summer, as they are still open for curbside and some mailing delivery as well. Over at 1172 Bay Street, Toronto, Ontario, Canada, you can give them a call at 416-964-9088. That's 416-964-9088. Or send them an email at baystreetvideoto@gmail.com for any of your DVD and Blu-ray needs.